So today we're going to be reading chapter 10 of The Six-Day Hero by Tamar Stein. It's called Irony. Yesterday, Gideon and Dad came home and they were talking about war, knowing that war's coming. And Gideon has hope. And his hope was because he knew that the Israelis were fighting for their homeland. They're fighting for their survival. Whereas the Jordanians and the Syrians and the Egyptians, they're just going to be fighting a war. They're not fighting for survival of their homeland, survival of life as they know it. So he's hopeful because he feels like that's going to make them more powerful. Because if they don't win, then there is no Israel anymore. Also interesting was the story about the Queen of Sheba and that she had a child by King Solomon. And when she went back to Ethiopia, all of the ancestors of that child were reigned as king in Ethiopia. So, and the Lion of Judah symbol. So it was cool because, of course, that part of the story is not in the Bible. Her visit is in the Bible. So that was interesting to me. And I'm like, I wonder, you know, if that's true or not. But it's certainly a part of Ethiopian culture and what they believe, that the Lion of Judah and their line of lineage of their kings. So we are going to pick up then in chapter 10. Let's see what's going on with Maddie. I wake up in the middle of the night in a sudden rush, not sure what's wrong. The room is pitch black, our window covered in a thick blanket that doesn't let in even a bit of moonlight. Maddie, my little brother moans. Maddie, I had an accident. I fumble with my sheet and feel my way to the wall switch. I blink until my eyes adjust to the sudden light. Benny sits in bed, sodden sheets twisted around his legs. The sharp smell of urine fills the room. Oh, Benny, I say in sleepy annoyance. Come on, you're not a baby. I had a bad dream. Our house caught on fire and Emma burned up. He says, and he starts to cry. I shiver at that image. All right, I say crossly. There's no need to fall to pieces. Come on. I pull him out of bed. Go to the bathroom and strip off the wet pajamas and wash your legs. I'll deal with the bed. He waddles down to the bathroom, keeping his wet legs apart. I stare at the mess on the bed. It's not just a little stain. He really wet it. I make a face as I grab a handful of wet sheets. When I pull it off the bed, I see that it is soaked through. There's a large wet circle on the mattress. I go to the bathroom, wet a towel, and scrub out the stain. When Benny comes back to the room, he pulls on a fresh pair of pajamas and unhugs his middle as we both look at his wet bed. You can sleep in Gideon's room, I say. I don't want to sleep there, Benny says in a small voice. He's wearing my old pajamas with green trucks on them. His skinned knees and knobby feet remind me how young he is. I forget sometimes. Fine, then I'll sleep there and you can have my bed. Benny pokes out his lower lip and stares at the floor. What? I sigh. It's late. I want to go back to sleep. I don't want to sleep by myself, he finally says in a tiny voice. I think about it. You want to squeeze in with me? His face lights up. Okay, I say. I can't help smiling back. You'd think I'd offered him the moon. But you have to promise not to kick. Of course, he vows. A thought occurs to me. And if you pee in my bed, Benny, I warn, I get Gideon's bed and you're sleeping on the floor. Benny draws himself up. I never wet the bed twice in one night, he says with dignity. Good. Come on. I'm tired. It takes us a little while to settle in comfortably, two boys in one narrow bed, but finally we find our comfy spot. I fall asleep with the warmth of my little brother tucked inside the curve of my chest and knees. His soft breaths keep me company, even in my dreams. Neither one of us has nightmares. The next morning, I skip school again. Our neighborhood is already fully equipped with sandbags, so I drift into the next section of town and help out. Today, in addition to the civil defense men and boys like me, we have three tall, blonde Germans. We keep sneaking glances at them. They were dropped off in a small van that didn't stay around. A lady just stuck her head out of the rolled-down window and shouted that they were volunteers and that she would be back to pick them up in the afternoon. They clearly want to help, but they don't speak Hebrew, and no one in our group knows any German. The older men especially have their shoulders tight and faces grim, unwilling to even try to communicate with the foreigners. "I'll be right back," I say, and scamper back to my building. "Mrs. Friedberg," I say when she opens the door, "we need a translator." "They're volunteers," Mrs. Friedberg explains to us after chatting with them. "So they say," says one of the civil defense men, sliding a suspicious sideways look at the tall, strapping German. "Boys like that ran my mother out of her house in Krakow, forced her on a cattle train to Auschwitz, and then killed her and my baby sister. If you think I'm turning my back on them, you have another thought coming." "Ah," Miss Friedberg snorts, "these boys are here to help, and you're a fool if you don't take them up on their offer." She sets them up with shovels and instructions. The three muscular young men happily get to work, laughing and joking in their deep voices. Apparently, while foreign governments are distancing themselves from our situation, young people from all over the world are coming in droves to personally help. The Germans tell Mrs. Friedberg that they are staying at a hostel with hundreds of Swedish, Canadian, and American volunteers. A hostel is like, think about like the YMCA, where you can go if you need it to stay for the night. This is kind of like that. You house people on a temporary basis. Mrs. Friedberg beams at the Germans. They have icy blue eyes and fair skin that has reddened in the sun. Their rapid German banter makes the others uncomfortable, but I have to give them this. They work hard. Compared to the old men of the civil defense and the schoolboys like me, they fly through the sand mound, filling the bags faster than people can carry them to the windows and doors. So, an American, a Brit, and an Israeli are hiking in the wild when they're caught by cannibals. Alright, so this is supposed to be a joke. An American, a Brit, and an Israeli are hiking in the wild when they're caught by cannibals. This is one of the civil defense men, taking a break as he leans against the handle of a shovel. The German volunteers eye him, but they continue with their work. The cannibals throw them all in a giant pot. "They're going to eat them," their chief says. "You can each have one last request." The American asks for a glass of whiskey. The Brit says, "I want a cigar." The Israeli says, "I want you to punch me in the face." The chief says, "What kind of request is that?" I know this joke. A different civil defense man told it to me yesterday. The Israeli says, "That's the only thing I want." Finally, the chief agrees, and he punches him in the face. The Israeli pulls out a gun and shoots the chief. The American and the Brit turn to him and say, "You had a gun all along? Why didn't you just use it?" And the Israeli says, "What, and have the UN accused me of being the aggressor?" The Israelis all laugh. The Germans exchange looks. Mrs. Friedberg rushes to translate, a look of dawning comprehension across their faces. They snort in amusement. The man who told the joke beams at them, and they smile back. Then one of them says something in German, looking earnestly at all of us. They all turn to look at Mrs. Friedberg. He says, "Yes, that's why they're here." After that, everyone is much easier around each other. When we finish all the sand piles, Mrs. Friedberg invites the Germans to her apartment for lunch. I walk with them through the quiet streets. There are hardly any cars, and many stores are closed now, that the people needed to work them are all stationed along our borders. All the windows are covered with tape and blackout covers. Sandbag walls are everywhere. The newspaper wrote that it costs Israel $20 million a day in lost economic revenue to keep so many people active in the reserve. For a little country like ours, that was already struggling with a weak economy and a lot of unemployment, that's money we can't afford.
It's one of the five precepts that Gideon explained to me. We can't afford to keep a large standing army. If Egypt and Syria just kept us mobilized long enough, the country would collapse without a single shot fired. Which means that the war that's coming our way will be here sooner rather than later. The Germans chat and laugh, clearly happy to be here. It seems strange to me that 25 years ago, young Germans like them killed millions of Jews, and now young Germans are here to help us. So you can see the confusion that that would cause if you are Jewish. Mrs. Friedberg tells me as we walk, as if reading my mind, the German government has just donated 20,000 gas masks. That's just ironic, I say. I expect her to jump down my throat. She doesn't like it when people insult Germany, the center of culture and learning. But instead, she just pats my back. Monty, she says, it's a gift for me to live to see this day. She has a contented, peaceful look that I've never seen on her face before. All these years, she's held on to her pride and affection for Germany, despite the terrible things that happened there. It couldn't have been easy. These three young Germans had just given her back something that an army of 3 million took away from her, true pride in her native country. But what about the situation, I asked. Threats keep flying our way over the radio airwaves, and foreign troops have continued to pour into Sinai and Jordan, swelling their armed forces, which already outnumbered us 10-1. Everyone knows that war is coming. People are calling it Hamantana, the wait. The entire country is on edge, knowing that war's coming. Every day the pressure building like a balloon that grows bigger and a little bigger, the thin skin stretched too tightly, and you know that soon it's going to blow. Mark my words, she assures me, Jordan won't enter the war. King Hussein is a reasonable, educated man. He knows there's no future in war with Israel. It's only the Syrians and the Egyptians we have to worry about. She pauses, considering. And the Iraqi brigades, but not Jordan. I think of my Jordanian soldier, the one who gave me candy and always winks at me. I think about my dad's childhood friend, Daoud. And then I remember the skinny Jordanian soldier with the dark glint in his eyes who aimed his rifle at me. I wonder which one is more like King Hussein. All right, now this is part two. It's called The War. So you know it's coming. Let's see if I can read chapter 11. I'm going to try. Chapter 11, June 5th, 1967. As we eat breakfast that morning, the air is suddenly split by the screaming jets of fighter planes roaring low overhead. I drop my fork and race to the window, pushing aside the heavy blanket that blocks my view. I search the sky, but the planes are long gone. My mom and I exchange looks. Do you think this is war? I ask. I glance over at Benny. He's gone pale. He puts down his bread and puts an uneasy hand over his stomach. Could be training runs, my mom says. She speaks calmly, but I hear the tension in her voice. There aren't any air raid sirens. Turn on the radio. I do, but there's no news. You're going to school, my mom tells her. She levels me a look. I mean it, Marty. No skipping. A few days ago, dear Mrs. Friedberg just had to mention to my mom that I've been filling sandbags during school hours. My National Defense days were abruptly cut short. My mom said I could help out after school, but not during school. This is the problem with Mrs. Friedberg. She is completely untrustworthy. A few minutes later, Benny and I are on our way to school. As we cross a narrow alley, a white flash passes in front of us. It's that green-eyed cat. It easily leaps on top of a metal trash can, and from there it bounds to a balcony crowded with potted plants. It balances gracefully along the balcony's wrought iron railing and then pauses to look at me over its shoulder. Did you see that? I exclaim. Benny looks up from his feet, looking at me and then all around. What? What are you talking about? He asks. I pointed toward the balcony and the acrobatic cat, but it's gone. The balcony's empty. Benny meets up with several boys from our street, and they walk the next 8 blocks to his grammar school together. I turn at the corner and head to my school. I'm sitting on the floor of Mora Pena's classroom, my back resting against the door, when the air raid siren suddenly wails. Everyone freezes. A few students start to gather their things. Leave your things, Mora Pina roars over the noise. This isn't a drill. Everyone rushes to their feet. Several chairs tip over and fall with a clatter. To the shelter, she yells, now. I scramble to my feet as 80 kids come surging toward me. I fumble with the doorknob. Finally, it gives and the door flies open. I stumble out of the classroom, my books and papers on the floor instantly trampled under dozens of feet. As soon as I step into the corridor, I'm carried along by the press of people. I couldn't turn around and go back to the classroom, even if I wanted to. There's organized chaos as everyone races toward the shelter near the schoolyard. Two teachers stand by the heavy metal door and urge students in. The siren wails and wails. Kids fly inside, stumbling over each other, plunging down the stairs into the dimly lit space. I focus on the open doorway of the shelter. My vision narrows until all I see is the dark rectangle of safety that beckons me. The siren screams, drowning out the shouts of the teachers, the cries of the students. My heart knocks painfully against my chest. This is it. That thought plays over and over in my mind. This is it. This is it. I make it into the shelter and find a place to sit on the damp, musty floor. The last student rushes in, the teacher stuck inside and pulls a blast-proof metal door closed. It shuts with a clang. They are barely down the stairs when the first explosion hits and the ground shudders. A few people scream. It's followed by more explosions, some loud and nearby, others fainter and farther away. I try to keep track how many, but I lose count. The teachers huddle in a corner, fiddling with a transistor radio someone thought to bring along. The radio crackles to life, but I can't hear it over the cries of the scared students. Children! Mora Pina cries, trying to get control of the room. Children, stay calm. Be quiet. But not even our strong-willed teacher can calm the crowd. I make my way over to the transistor, stepping over huddled students. I need to hear what's going on. The teachers have turned the dial to Kol Israel, the official Israeli radio station, but it only plays music. Mora Pina turns the dial. Radio Cairo blasts in Hebrew. Radio Cairo blasts in Hebrew. Arise, go forth to battle. The hour of glory is here. Our airplanes and our missiles at this moment are shelling all Israel's towns and villages. She turns the dial again. Radio Damascus reports. Silence the enemy. Destroy him. Liberate Palestine. The Syrian Air Force has begun to bomb Israeli cities and to destroy its positions. Changing stations again, I hear King Hussein speaking on Radio Amman saying, the hour of revenge has come. It's Jordan, Mora Pina says in a flat voice. King Hussein has thrown his lot in with Nasser of Egypt, which Mrs. Friedberg said would not happen. It's the worst possible news. Little Israel, only 19 years old, is now fighting a war on three fronts against three different armies, all at the same time. And if you look at your map, and if you look at a different map than this one, because this one's blown up a little bit. Israel looks kind of bigger than it actually is. You go to your globe or your map. Israel's very tiny compared to its neighbors. I think bitterly of Mrs. Friedberg's assurances. I should have known better than to believe her. I suddenly picture Yossi far away in Morocco, all the people who forecasted doom and death. With a horrible sense of realization, I see that they were right. A rising wave of terror like nothing I've ever felt before washes over me. War has come to Jerusalem, and with it, perhaps the end of our Jewish country and our lives. Another explosion rattles the ground. The teachers have all served in the military. They discuss the possibility of invasion by Jordanian ground troops. Shelling West Jerusalem is one thing. Bad, of course, but nothing compared to the utter slaughter of ground troops going house to house. There are also Egyptian and Iraqi troops currently in Jordan as part of a joint forces agreement. Both the Jordanians and the Iraqis have particularly fearsome reputations, well-trained and lethal, and the border is not even a 10-minute walk from our school. As if in agreement with the teacher's grim predictions, another explosion goes off. We all instinctively duck and cover our heads as the ground trembles around us. I can't stand the thought of being stuck in my school's bunker when my mom is at home by herself. I have to get to her. Mora Pina, I say, I need to go home. No, she says, absolutely not. She turns to one of the pale, bug-eyed teachers next to her. Open the boxes with the chocolate bars, pass them out. I'll give the students something to distract them. Right now, we can all use the sugar. Mortar pina! I try again. Here, she says, and shoves a box of candy bars at me. Take one. But, I say, holding the box, I don't, Mati. It would be suicide to leave the bunker right now. Mortar pina is quite tall for a woman, and the top of her head nearly brushes the ceiling. She hunches down, leaning over me. The dim light casts long shadows on her face. I know you want to go home, but your mom will kill me if I let you go now. As soon as there's a lull in the shelling, you can leave, okay? But right now, help me get these students calm. Some of them are hyperventilating. Give them a candy bar. I slip one of the bars in my pocket and make my way to my friend. I plop down and hand the box over to David. He reaches in, grabs the bar, and passes the box down. I much prefer to worry about my mom than to think about Gideon and my dad. I hope Benny is doing okay. It tears me up to think of him so scared in his school's bunker as the shells explode. Benny has my old teacher, Mora Rivka. I always liked her. She'll keep a cool head under pressure. I hope she keeps an eye on Benny. I don't have a watch, but Moishi does.
Moishi.
An hour passes. Then another. I can't keep still. We finish the chocolate bars. Some kids eye the boxes of sweet crackers, but Mortia Pina holds them off. We need to pace ourselves, she says. What she means is, we don't know how long we'll be stuck here, so let's not eat all the food in a couple of hours. Time moves achingly slowly. Again and again, there are rumbles of explosions. More jets fly overhead. Mortar Pina catches my eye and shakes her head no. I can't leave, not yet. We sit. We wait. We listen to the radio for news. After 6 hours, I've had it. I feel ill from too much chocolate and sitting still for so long. My mind races with worries for my mom. She's probably beside herself with worry. None of her boys is with her. Not one. I weave between the tight groups of kids to get over to the teachers. They sit leaning against the rough cement brick wall, lost in their own world of worry. There hasn't been any shelling for half an hour, I tell her. She shakes her head no. The all clear hasn't sounded, she says. Let me run home, I say. I can be there in 3 minutes flat, less if I really sprint. Moria Pina hesitates, thinking. I have to go, I tell her. I'm going crazy. She rubs a hand across her face. She lowers it and searches my face. Okay, she nods, looking pale. You can go. Listen up, she says, raising her voice. Anyone who lives in the immediate neighborhood, that's 2 or 3 minutes away at the most, if you want to run home, you can right now. You do not have to go, but if you want, you can. A frightened hush falls over the crowd. I can see the kids who live nearby frantically thinking whether they want to risk it or not. Make a decision now, Mortar Pina says, anxiety sharpening her voice. I'm opening the door for exactly 30 seconds. I walk to the door. My heart is thumping hard and fast. I bounce on my toes, ready to sprint for my life. I look over my shoulder. Most of the kids have stayed put, but David and Moishi, along with a couple of kids from the other grades, have come forward. Mortar Pina nods. Good luck, she says. Chazak Zamak. Be strong and brave. It's an ancient blessing given by Moses to the Israelites before they crossed the Jordan River. We studied it in class. She unlatches the door and pushes it open. Sun streams in. Just another sunny day in June. Go, she says. Run! We do. At first, we're all packed in, jostling through the door and out into the schoolyard. Then we scatter, 5 kids running in all directions, sprinting for home. I race through the narrow streets that I strolled down just this morning. There's not a soul out. The sounds of my pounding feet and whistling breath are the only signs of human life. They echo off the buildings. The blue skies seem to mock me. The silence feels ominous. Every second I'm out in the open is reckless. I run like I've never run before. The street seems to stretch out like like in a nightmare, getting longer and longer. I pump my arms, leaning forward. A building has been hit and rubble is strewn in the street. I clamber over it, quick and light on my feet. The laundry lines have snapped. Shirts and underwear hang down the side of the building like wilted leaves on a vine. Glass shards glitter and flash on the ground like a field full of diamonds. Suddenly, there's a scream of jet engines. It's so loud, I feel it vibrating in the soles of my feet and up my legs. Four mirage jets shoot overhead, flying in a tight diamond formation. Without meaning to, I come to a stop, amazed to see them. The Israeli Air Force emblem, a blue star in a white circle, winks for a second on their wings before they're gone. I blink, standing in the empty street, and I take off again, running as fast as I can. And we've got to stop there for today. Man, I don't know if I would have gone running home. Maybe so. He's brave.